our mind. Moreover, there appears to be nothing else to blame for state vector collapse. Everything else is something physical, and as a physical system must be subject to the Schrödinger equation. At best, it can only create more potential states, not remove them. Yet when we observe the system, we know that state vector collapse has occurred because we only see one state, one of the psi component states. The mind or consciousness affects matter. Page 98. It's clear that as far as physics is concerned, the brain, though complex, does not have in its chemical processes anything that would alter the results of the Schrödinger equation without changing what the equation itself says. Yet when consciousness enters, everything changes. The physics of Schrödinger, of Heisenberg, Einstein, and Bohr, of von Neumann, neither provides any explanation of consciousness, nor gives us any place to put it, except beyond the edges of quantum theory, where the state vector becomes the picture we see. Von Neumann himself traces this act of observation back to the very edge of our mind. Wigner concludes, "The very study of the external world led to the conclusion that the content of the consciousness is an ultimate reality." It says that on page 99. Interpretations of quantum mechanics. Walker shows the Copenhagen interpretation, the stochastic ensemble interpretation, the Everett's many worlds interpretation, and he shows the hidden variable interpretations. He discusses the various interpretations, and then he discusses Bell's theorem. He's noting that there are still very many interpretations of quantum physics, and not all of them agree. The next stop, on page 138, he says, "I need to clarify something, and high time, you may say. I need to clarify a particular point about Bell's theorem and the direction we have to take because of Bell's theorem. Bell's theorem essentially proved the non-locality of particles. That is, they are spread throughout and interconnected throughout all of space, no matter how far they are from each other. To review very briefly, we have found that quantum mechanics itself seemed to require an observer in order to make the Copenhagen interpretation work. Others, including Einstein and Bell, tried to show quantum mechanics, or at least the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, to be wrong. And this attempt led to the tests of Bell's theorem. Those tests showed instead that any effort to picture the physical world in terms of local and objective reality, that is, as independently existing objects, would yield results that are inconsistent with the known behavior of atomic phenomenon. What we have done, therefore, is to say that maybe the original idea, the Copenhagen interpretation, which tacitly assumes a conscious observer to affect the things observed, is correct. We are exploring the possibility that the solution to the Bell's theorem paradox, if you will, lies in understanding what the observer is. I am not saying, and this is the point I want to clear up, that introducing consciousness into physics is the only possible way of dealing with the Bell's theorem results. I believe that all other efforts to patch up the physicalistic ideas will lead either nowhere or to some epicyclic morass. Such confused efforts to develop non-local hidden variable theories have already been looked into, and so far, entirely unsuccessfully. Examples of such efforts assume non-local hidden variables that know when a measurement is being made, but those dedicated to a physicalistic view of the world will have to explore those avenues. I have looked at this interpretation and found it wanting. It had already been examined and discredited by hundreds of the most capable physicists before Bell came on the scene. For me, Bell's theorem is the final nail in the coffin. But, as I said, Bell's theorem does not prove that consciousness plays a role in physical processes. We're going to prove that, not by looking further into Bell's theorem or further into quantum mechanics, but by searching out consciousness itself. We're going to understand what consciousness is. It says that on page 138, and this text is about 370 pages. It's a huge text. I haven't completely read it, I must confess. I've been looking into it, and it's very, very good. His idea, see, he allows that there are other interpretations. He's not saying his is the final conclusion, but he's saying, look, I'm going to take this idea at least seriously so that I can explore the ramifications of it. And I like that approach. What I'm simply showing you is that based upon some difficult and various interpretations of the quantum, we can come to some amazing, startling ideas on what physical reality is. And it's not what we've been taught at all. We are actual participants in the creation of this universe through our consciousness. Now, the medieval scholastics said God is mind. Well, don't make fun of that much anymore. Now, see, Hugh Nibley pooh-poohed that somewhat. He said, you know, they disregarded the physical. Well, be that as it may, the point is, mind is the creation aspect of physicality. We are intimately entwined and intertwined and connected. We are partners with God in an ongoing creation. The problem with classical Christian theology is the assumption, based on a misreading of the biblical text, that God created once and for all way back when, and nothing else has happened. Well, that picture is completely overturned now by quantum physics. Creation is an ongoing process. This is why John F. Haupt, in God After Darwin, A Theology of Evolution, is such a powerful text. Not only does it sweep away some incorrect religious assumptions about God, but he also sweeps away some of the incorrect implications of science of evolution as a basis that God is not needed or that God does not exist. On both sides, he takes a middle ground that is very powerful. Quantum physics is an astonishing discipline in and of itself. I'm going to encourage you to keep studying it, to keep trying to learn about it. I've enjoyed doing it. As I learn new information from time to time, I'll make more podcasts. So thanks for joining me in this Backyard Professor podcast series. I'll see you next time on the podcasts. Have a great life.